In this module, we're talking about subatomic particles, nuclear decay, and nuclear equations that describe that nuclear decay. So first, let's talk about some subatomic particles. We have the proton and their symbols. You should memorize the symbols and the names for these. We have an H, just like for hydrogen, and we have the one to the top, on the top to its left, and one on the bottom to its left. Or a P, the same way. These mean the same thing. They stand for a proton. Now, the number on top, it's basically the mass number, the number of protons plus the number of neutrons in the nucleus. The number on the bottom, it's really the atomic number, the number of protons. But because we have weird things like a negative one, the way it might help to think about this as the charge on the species. So we have a proton, one and one. We have an electron, also called a beta particle. It could be either an E, zero on top, negative one on bottom, or a beta. That's supposed to be a beta, zero, negative one. We have a positron, which is the anti-particle of the electron. Its symbol is E or beta, zero on top. The difference is it has a positive one down here on the bottom. A neutron, one and zero, symbol N. A gamma ray. A gamma ray is really not a particle. It's really electromagnetic radiation, a high-energy photon, so zero and zero. And an alpha particle, which is really a helium nucleus with no electrons. It's either a symbol alpha, the four on top, two on the bottom, or HE, like for helium, four and two. So memorize these guys. So when we have a nuclear equation that describes nuclear decay or nuclear reactions, it looks something like this down here. Now, the thing about nuclear equations that's going to make them really easy for you is that the one thing that has to be true is that when you add up all of the numbers in the top on the left of the arrow, they must equal all the numbers on the top to the right of the arrow. All the mass, the sum of the mass numbers on the left must equal the sum of the mass numbers on the right. So here we have iodine 135, we have 135 here, 135 plus 0 is 135 here. And the same is true for the atomic number, the charge number on the bottom. We have, because it's iodine, its atomic number is 53. And over here we have 54, which makes it xenon, minus one is 53. So you see this adds up to be this. We call the nuclide. The nuclide is something that's like an isotope, but it's involved in a nuclear process. We call the one on the left of the arrow the parent nuclide, one on the right the daughter nuclide. So you should know what those terms mean. Notice, okay, that it's still true that the number of protons determines which element this species is. So if we know what this number has to be down here, for example, like say if we figured out somehow that it had to be 54, we would know that this is xenon. All right, so let's do a few examples. We're going to react cobalt 59, and because it's cobalt, its atomic number is 27, with a neutron. And you're told that it makes manganese 56. So what is this over here? Well, you just make the numbers add up. 59 plus 1 is 60. That means 56. We need four more, right? So we know that the top number is 4. On the bottom, 27 plus 0 is 27. 25, we need two more. So that's 2. 4 and 2, that's an alpha particle, or a helium nucleus. So that's the answer for that. Now, technetium 99 to ruthenium 99. Well, notice I did not give you the atomic numbers down here. That's because you can look them up on a periodic table. So if you look technetium up, you see that it has an atomic number of 43. You can put it down there. And ruthenium is 44. Knowing that, 99 here, so that means we know we're going to have a zero on top. And on the bottom, 43. 44. We have to take 1 away from 44 to make it 43, so it's negative 1. 0 and negative 1 is an electron or a beta particle. So that's that. Now, curium 241 reacting with something to make americium 241. Okay, so let's put the atomic numbers in. So we're just looking on the periodic table. Curium is atomic number 96. Americium is atomic number 95. So we say 241, they're the same. That means that this particle has to have a zero on top. Put it over here. 96 here and 95 here, we have to take one away from 96, so it's negative one, which makes it an electron. So this process is called electron capture, by the way. So that's the answer for that. So that's how you figure these things out. It's pretty easy. Now, here are the types of radioactive decay that we're going to talk about here. First one, you've seen a couple of them already, is called alpha emission. Alpha emission, or alpha decay, produces an alpha particle, this one right here, as one of its products. If you know what you're starting with, just like we did, you can figure out where this guy is over here. Next, beta emission, or beta decay. One of the products is a beta particle, or an alpha, or an electron. Okay, so let's talk about that. The difference between a beta particle and electron, there is no difference. They're the same thing. But these beta particles are emitted from a nucleus, and a nucleus does not contain any electrons. So the distinction really is that a beta particle is an electron that it's been produced by a radioactive decay. It's made. Whereas an electron, it existed outside the nucleus. I'll talk about it down here. gamma ray emission, like this right here. It's, a gamma ray is given off. Positron emission, releasing a positron. And electron capture. So now here, what happens here is that an electron that's close to the nucleus is captured by the nucleus, right? Or a 1s electron most likely. And, so it's on the left-hand side of the arrow here. Now let's look. The net result of beta emission, okay, when you produce, how is this electron produced, beta particle produced? You can think about it as the conversion of a neutron into a proton. Right? You see the numbers add up, one here, 0 and 1 is 1, 0, -1, and +1. So this is going to be important in just a moment. For gamma ray emission, you can think about this as the annihilation of matter and antimatter. An electron and its antiparticle, a positron, when they collide, they produce a lot of energy, gamma rays. Positron emission, essentially, the net result of that is the conversion of a proton into a neutron. And electron capture does the same thing, really, converts a proton into a neutron. Why do we care about that? Well, because when we're looking at whether or not a nucleus will decay, whether or not it's stable, there's this band of stability, and what determines whether or not a nuclide falls within this band of stability is the ratio of the number of neutrons to the number of protons. If there are too many neutrons for the number of protons that there are, it's going to decay down. It's going to try to, when it decays to fall into this band of stability. And the way it can decay if it's up here is through beta emission, because remember, beta emission or beta decay converts a neutron into a proton. So we had too many, the ratio of neutrons to protons was too big, so if we convert a neutron into a proton, that gets it closer to this band of stability. On the other hand, if a nuclide is down here, it's unstable because the ratio of neutrons to protons is too small. There aren't enough neutrons or there are too many protons. Then what's going to happen is either positron or emission or electron capture. Remember, both of those guys increase the number of neutrons by creating a neutron and decreasing the number of protons. So it is up into here.